quarter, they introduced the Mountaineer basketball team, and it will be a team that has had a lot of success under John Beilein, but instead it's Bob Huggins taking over at his alma mater. And I talked to him on Thursday. He said he's delighted to be back in Morgantown.
And I know you're very familiar with the Round Ballers, and this should be very interesting, and it won't be long before Bob Huggins has everyone in the country knowing about the Mountaineer basketball program.
Well, he's posing for pictures. In fact, I think he was leading the parade on High Street, the homecoming parade last night on High Street in downtown Morgantown.
Well, I tell you, he's smiling like he slept with a hanger in his mouth. You know, he's grinning from ear to ear.
And he's happy to be here. Now, Mississippi State has had the ball to start a possession. This one is loose again. Who's got it? And it looks like the Bulldogs have it. Aubrey Bell, I think, was the guy that came up with it, but we'll unpile underneath. Shelton got the recovery to keep possession. That could have been disastrous right there.
Ouch, and this could have been bad. This is, again, an opportunity that Mississippi State can ill afford to have the ball, not only turn the ball over, but deep in their own territory and just hand the ball over to West Virginia with an opportunity to score more points. It hits a guy, he jumped up in the air, didn't get a good grab at it.
And then he kicked it.
And he kicked the ball, but made matters worse, kicked it away from all teammates. But they do have possession. Wesley Carroll hopefully can muster some type of offense this series.
Well, Jala was the closest to getting to that football for West Virginia and could not come up with it. Dixon, stutter step. He's got about three. Dixon. Chris Neld made the tackle. You see Hathaway in there defensively now, Bobby Hathaway. One of the seniors, a backup at linebacker, backing up Reed Williams, who leads the Mountaineers in tackles. But they've got enough bodies. I was at practice the other day. They've got about 125 guys in uniform at practice. That's unbelievable.
Yeah. And you know, I think when you're playing Dixon, you know he's going to run those gaps and stuff. And you know, the guys up front just shoot the gaps and just control those gaps, and that certainly changes the way he's going to run up the line.
Well, they showed a five-man rush, backed out of it to four, and Dixon will be knifed under as he gets back to the line of scrimmage. Morty Ivey, who has 38 tackles and four sacks coming into the game. He's one of those Western Pennsylvania players played from Monroeville, Pennsylvania. Morty Ivey.
You know, last year, Dixon, 9 totes, 15 yards. He kind of feels like he has something to prove this game, but he's having a rough go thus far, John.
Yeah. Because they're showing him a five-man front, then they'll back out of it, then they'll come up and split those gaps, as you said. They're giving him a different look
every time.
And
it's confusing that quarterback. Not sure if they're coming with a blitz or not.
It's going to be third down and four. Long was the motion man. They'll kick it out to Dixon. That's incomplete. And even if he catches it, Prene, he's not going anywhere, I don't think.
No, West Virginia is running. They react very, very well. And you can see as he delivers the ball, everyone is really skating to that spot where the ball is going to be delivered. You see Carroll dropping back, trying to sell. He's going to the right, throwing to that way. But you see a bunch of gold jerseys right there on Dixon, even if he catches it. But I think you heard footsteps that time, and he's getting a little tentative.
Well, it's one thing that Coach Kroom talked about that he feared the most was the speed of West Virginia, both offense, defense, special teams, and this is not an especially good kick either. It's a little bit of a bounce. Rivers has it. He'll go down after a return of about three on the play. Well, once again, pretty good field position for the Mountaineers, a 31-yard kick. Well, West Virginia set to go back to work, and they've done plenty so far. It's 31-0 Mountaineers with 13:10 left to halftime. Mississippi State. We'll tell you more about that soccer team in a moment. Again, good field possession. The ball at the 39-yard line out of the I formation. Straight ahead running, nothing there. That'll be a no-gainer. He's pushed back. A lot of folks in there. Cheney was there. The UConn men's soccer team came to town last night. They were ranked number one in the country, and they lost to West Virginia 1-0. A walk-on scored the only goal of the night last night. So things are pretty happy right now here in Morgantown, West Virginia. Out of the gun with Schmidt and Slayton alongside, it's Patrick White. Broke that 64-yard run on his first carry this afternoon. Straight pass, throws, Schmidt makes the catch. Tackled from behind as he gets back to the line of scrimmage. That was Titus Brown, who stayed with him, a senior from Tuscaloosa, Alabama.
Boy, this says a lot for a 6'3", 250-pound, one of the best pass rushers in the SEC. Watch, he peels off from his defensive end position, smells us out, good pursuit, and catches him from behind. You know, he's a 4'6", 6'6" guy, and a defensive end. The pro scouts love this guy as a pass rusher.
Well, he goes back to the tight end. White looking, looking, throwing. Intercepted. Intercepted by Bobo. Intended for Hogan, but it was short, and Bobo was right there to make the test. Demario Bobo gets his second interception of the season.
He runs an out route, and Patrick White is rolling that way. It throws where there's two white jerseys, and just threw a little behind. He throws on the outside, it's complete. Throws on the inside where Bobo was stationed, and that was Patrick White's second interception of the season, but only mistake he's made thus far.
K.J. Wright deflected it. I think that ball was deflected. That's the reason it came up short. Somebody got a piece of it from midfield. This is the second best field position that they have had. Dupree is in the lineup. And he will get inside West Virginia territory. Johnny Holmes makes the tackle. Let's go back and see this pass deflection that set up the interception right there.
Yes, you can see the trajectory has changed a little bit. It's deflected. It's not a spiral anymore. And
it's a good catch by Bobo, though, to
make
the play.
Good concentration, John.
Well, the Mountaineers turn it over for the first time, and that is the first time that they have not scored points when they've had an offensive possession. 11 and a half to go till halftime. Out of the I formation again. But it's Dupree now as the tailback behind Hoskins. Fake to Dupree, pressure on the freshman, down he goes. Johnny Dingle with sack number 6, and there is a flag down. Johnny Dingle is a load, I'm telling you that. 270, looks bigger than that. He's from Miami. That was his 6th sack of the year.
He's a highly regarded 2003 signee with the Florida Gators. But he's really turned it up a notch this season, knowing his senior season. Good size, 6'3", 270, could be a good rusher on the edge.
Face mask, number 92, defense.
So it's on Dingle.
5-yard penalty from the
previous spot.
That's
how he got back there, I guess.
Replay second down.
Well, it's a 5-yard penalty for an incidental face mask, and so Carroll will get another chance with some positive yards.
He does everything right except grab the iron.
Did grab it, just barely.
And he pulled it around. You know, the thing about this is a multiple pro-style offense. The running game, it's imperative. The running game is successful for this offense to work, John. And when you do play action, it's not going to sell anybody, and that's really why Dingle and company were in the backfield.
Well, it's Wesley Carroll with a 52% rating coming in, 52% of his passes, and he'll send two wideouts to the left side. Hoskins is the fullback. You've got Long and Bell both split to the left. Tight end is Sherrod. Dupree very close to a first down. Keelan Dykes makes the tackle right at the Mountaineer 40-yard line. We are at Mountaineer Field at Milan Puskar Stadium. Mississippi State against the team ranked number 9 in the BCS, that's West Virginia. They are ranked 7th in the coaches poll, 9th in the AP poll, and 9th in that all-important BCS. They're going to measure to see if he got the first down.
We'll look at Sylvester Kroon, who's coached for the Green Bay Packers, Detroit Lions, San Diego Chargers, Buccaneers, and the Colts.
And, of course, he coached WVU's offensive coordinator, Calvin McGee.
Calvin McGee, a native of New Orleans, and he played for Southern University and the Tampa Bay Buccaneers. Wow.
Well, as if they haven't had enough to cheer about here in Morgantown, they start the wave. I thought that's when you got bored. They can't be bored. It's 31 to nothing.
We got 3 quarters to go. Obviously, they have to go for this. You know, you talked a little bit about Wesley Carroll. 33 attempts against the Bowles last week. A couple of scoring tosses. But, you know, this running game must move for him to open up things a little bit. And they'll have to make some adjustments. They really got Dixon bottled up. West Virginia defense.
Well, they've got Dixon back in there right now at the tailback spot after Christian Dupree, a transfer from Tulane, ran a couple of plays, but now it's Dixon again. McCray split wide left. It's a power line formation. two tight ends, Sherrod and Butler, for the Bulldogs, trying to pick up a first down. Dixon will have it inside the 40 to the 39, and that is their first down of the afternoon. Bobby Hathaway on the tackle.
Good blocking by Blackledge and Strouder. Make that Jenkins on the right side allow, gave him a little cushion, converging, as you see, trying to block up front for him, and Blackledge, the center, did a good job for him.
It took him 19 and a half minutes to pick up a first down. We still got 10 to go here in this opening half. 31-0 Mountaineers. Now they go back and spread two wideouts to the left, one to the right. And Dixon is the running back, and the pass over the middle is complete. Anthony Bell makes the catch. He'll be brought down near the 27-yard line by Johnny Holmes, and that is his first completion of the afternoon.
And Bell makes his eighth grab. Good protection as Carroll drops back, delivers the ball. See him right here, just a little curl right in the middle. And that's, I like this because you have to loosen things up. You can't go deep and vertical until you loosen up that defense a little bit and get him thinking pass, at least give your quarterback some confidence, your offensive line. So if you have to work the ball down the field with short passing game, that works.
Ducree is back in there at running back. They'll go from the gun with the two freshmen, Wesley Carroll, running the offense. Three wideouts left. Play fake. No, the handoff is to Ducree, who gets down to maybe about the 31. JT Thomas, who's been battling injuries and suspensions this year. We weren't sure that Thomas was going to play because of a hamstring problem. But he's in there, you see him making that play. Of course, Wicks is one of the veterans in that secondary.
It's a handoff to Ducree, following his blockers. Good pull right there and block. And Ducree, as you said, played a two-lane. He's not played a two-lane in the early 90s. And he's out of Mandeville, Louisiana. And they're glad to have me. Adds a little dimension, and it backs up, gives Anthony Dixon a blow now and then.
Again, it's third and short. McCray is split left. They've got double tight ends in Sherrod and Butler. Dixon. No, will not get there. Excuse me, it's Ducree, not Dixon. And Ducree is not going to pick up the first down. And once again, big Johnny Dingle there defensively for the Mountaineers. And only his face mask had that sack taken away earlier. So it's fourth down and four. And you see Carroll comes off. The entire offensive unit heads over to the bench because the kick team's going to come on.
They blew it up right there, and also a good penetration by Antonio Lewis and company. And so good penetration by the West Virginia defense.
And Mississippi State is going to take their first timeout. Just trying desperately, Renee, to get something going, down 31-0. Mountaineers still have all three of their timeouts remaining, and they've got the huge lead. Scored 28 in the first quarter, leading now by 31. Well, movement on the left side. Now that may change this strategy right here. Everything that could go wrong pretty much has gone wrong here in the first half.
Looks like Eric Butler may have moved prematurely, number 88.
Before the snap, false start, number 88, offense. 5-yard penalty, still fourth down.
Third penalty against Croom's club, 15 yards in penalties, and that will bring on the kicking team.
You know, you look at Sylvester Croom, you think of that song, Mama Said There'll Be Days Like This.
Yep, well, it has been so far. McAdams will kick. Von Rivers is standing inside his own 10-yard line. Well, the penalties, the turnovers at costly points. That's the thing of it.
Yeah, and West Virginia has made them pay for every opportunity they've gotten, every gift.
Kind of pooches that kick down there, and Rivers is going to run away from it, but it's going to take a good bounce for State to the one. 37-yard kick, but effective because it sets them down inside the 1-yard line. In that last break, they introduced the women's basketball team here, Renee, and they are getting some attention around the country. They finished fourth in the Big East last year. Mike Carey's their coach, and they are ranked in the top 20. One of the good news for the women's basketball team. A young lady by the name of Meg Bulger, who's had all kinds of physical problems, is back for her redshirt senior season. You might have heard of her brother, Mark.
I've heard him somewhere before. You know, and she's quite a player. And,
yes,
and an inspiration. You know, a story like that, John, is really going to motivate the rest of her teammates to see where she's come back from and what she can do.
Well, you see Bob Huggins is still with us down on the field. Now, this is the first time the Mountaineers have had bad field position. And they're going to try to power it out behind the running of Owen Schmidt.
Owen Schmidt.
Kyle Love, number 95, was there defensively. We've got John Butera up here doing our stats today. And since electronically everything is done on computers at these stadiums, but the system here is out.
Well,
so John's gone through three pens already.
And numerous pads.
But he's hanging in there.
And he does a great job. He has a calculator and his shoes and socks off.
That's right.
So we won't miss a yard.
Got all the toes and fingers working for him. Second down. Schmidt again is the lone setback. Schmidt trying to get outside, won't do it. They stuffed him right at the line of scrimmage. Bowen and Douglas that time, and they're not going to let him run up the middle on this play. They're going to force him to go outside.
And this could be a motivation to the offense if the defense can somehow hold West Virginia down this far near their goal line and somehow get the ball back in good field position. So a defensive stand here can certainly motivate the offense. But, boy, I tell you what, it's tough to keep this offense bottled up, this spread offense. And, again, we said earlier, Mississippi State never faces this.
Well, they do not use Schmidt this time. They throw the football downfield. Overthrown. It was intended for Darius Raynaud. The fans and Raynaud wanted a call on the play, and they decided to go for it. I'm kind of surprised, I think, that they didn't move quite around a little bit more on that play.
Yeah, he was more of a drop back there, and although he's second in the Big East in passing efficiency.
East and Long are deep, and right from the dead back of the end zone, it'll be Pat McAfee to do the punting. Out of the snap of Adam Hughes. End over end. Pegues at the 30. Dragged down from behind, and that will be the best field position Mississippi State has had this entire ball game. Tippy Hale made the tackle. You know, the difference, a 39-yard kick with a 9-yard return that time. Total yards for West Virginia, 233. For the Bulldogs, 37.
That last series defensively was pretty good for Mississippi State. And again, that was all started by that good punt that was down to the 1-yard line. Kind of took away some of the options that.
Sure did. They did not take any chances. Actually, the last pass play was basically overthrown,
yeah,
thrown away.
Just thrown away. And it was set up that punt and kind of lived the fight another day.
Well, we'll see. It's 31-0. Hoskins, Dixon in the I formation. If you won't see Hoskins carry the ball, you will see Dixon play action fake. Under pressure, the throw is caught at the 10. It'll be first and goal for the Bulldogs. Good throw that time by the freshman because he got some pressure. Smith made the reception. A 22-yard pickup. Jamel Smith with the catch.
And Jamel Smith just runs a deep dig as Wesley Carroll just drops back, waits for him to make a break, and right inside. Pretty good pattern at his zone coverage. Cover two, and nice throw and catch. And Jamel Smith with his 17th grab of the season. A walk-off.
And it was once again Dingle who was in there defensively. They line up again in the I formation. Two wide receivers to the near side, one in the slot. Also in there is Burks. Dixon hesitates, five. He's going to be wrestled down right at the line of scrimmage. That is the veteran Eric Wicks from Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, the redshirt or the senior who makes the tackle.
And the thing is, you got to get Dixon running downhill, north-south, not east-west, and they make him bounce outside. Dixon starts there, and look, he's running sideways here, and you cannot do that. He has to put those shoulders, square those shoulders, and run north and south, and when you do that, you won the battle.
Second and goal from the 7, did not pick up anything. Clock running. Dixon fights his way down to about the 2.5-3 yard line. Johnny Holmes makes the tackle from his linebacker spot. But some positive yards that time by Dixon. We showed you Dixon, right? This is kind of where he excels down here in these short yardage situations.
He's a red zone type runner, and good field shot right here as Dixon just lowers those shoulder pads, good pad level, and digging, good blocking on Greg Jenkins, his partner, 75.
Absolutely.
And gets him close where he can sniff. They need a score here as we under the 5-minute mark. Good look at Keelan Knights.
Ball's at the 3, third and 3. Hoskins, the fullback in front of Dixon. Double tight, lone wide receiver is McRae. No, he will not get there. This time it's Hathaway stepping up defensively for the Mountaineers, and Dixon is denied again. Do they try to punch it in here on fourth down, or do they take three?
I think you have to go for the three, and this is just good feel right here as you see the linebacker coming across, Hathaway and company, along with Wicks, just filling that gap and giving him nowhere to run. I don't know. You know, it's close here. I guess 6-1, half dozen, but you need points this series. You definitely need points as you approach the halftime.
It's at the one-yard line. Sherrod and Butler, the double tight, and we've got a timeout. The second one taken by the Bulldogs.
You have to make this call right, John, and make sure you want points. You do not want to get shut down short of the end zone, because that could really demoralize you as you're down by 31 points. You need points any way you can get it.
You know, I'll tell you what, too. If you figure that your biggest weapon, it's a first and goal at the 7-yard line, is Dixon, you're going to go to him in this situation. You're going to go to him on fourth down, too, I would think.
Exactly. And the thing is, he has not had much success running against this Mountaineer defense, which is fifth rated in the entire country.
Well, be sure to stay with us for halftime. We'll have comments from the field. And we'll also update scores and standings. And once again, some surprises again in college football. We'll have highlights of the first half. We'll check off the stats. Halftime from Morgantown. It's all coming up in about 4 minutes football time.
Let me give you a superlative, John. West Virginia, one of three schools that is in the top 16 in scoring offense, total offense, scoring defense, and total defense. The other two, Kansas and Boise State. Kind of interesting.
Wow, it is interesting. Well, this is a Mississippi State team that has rushed for at least 135 yards six straight games, and they are not there so far this afternoon. Three tight ends. Hoskins in front of Dixon. Dixon flags down. He's going to be in the end zone, but let's wait and see, because we've got a flag. Ryan Mundy made the tackle. It is good for a touchdown, but if it's a legal procedure, it could be a very painful penalty, again at the wrong time for Mississippi
Offsides,
State.
Offsides, number 96, defense.
Oh, it's against.
Penalties declined.
It's a touchdown.
Touchdown.
It was Keelan Dykes who was offside on the play. So that time they did not shoot themselves in the foot. They get six. Adam Carlson now for the extra point. He is 19 of 20. In point afters, and he'll get a chance here. Out of the hold of McAdams. And he drills it through. It is 31-7. There was a little confusion on the fourth down and one play, but the offsides went against West Virginia. And Dixon cutting it outside, lowers his head, takes on his defender, gets in the zone. 31-7, WV. All right, we get set for the kickoff after the touchdown by Mississippi State. They forced it into the end zone, so the defense regrouping. It took them five plays to go 29 yards, and Dixon picks up another touchdown. He has been a touchdown machine for the Bulldogs. Dixon, that's his 11th rushing touchdown of the year.
Which leads the SEC.
That's impressive. Raynaud, Rivers, and Sanders are deep to receive the kick. And it is taken by Raynaud inside the end zone. Raynaud tries to go back outside and slips down as he gets across the 20 to the 21-yard line. Bobo up there. Bobo who had that interception earlier in the ballgame. Raynaud is cut down, but he'll stick around.
You know, a little interesting story about Raynaud. You know, if you think of the guys who are the hold the squat record on this team, you think of the Stan Checks or the Keelan Dykes. No, it's Darius Raynaud with a squat of 695. Tremendous explosion in those legs.
At the 21, Mountaineers will have it. First and 10. White has gone the distance at quarterback. It's Schmidt and Slayton split alongside him as he works out of the shotgun. Two wide receivers left, another wide receiver to the right. Inside handoff, Slayton, nothing there. He lost a yard as he was banged back. Dominic Douglas leading the way in there along with Avery Hannibal. Strong defense that time. And certainly I think getting the touchdown probably picks up your entire attitude.
It really does. You know, it spills over to the offense and the defense, and when special teams do well, and that's certainly that touchdown. And And that defensive stand, which made West Virginia punt last series, also spilled over to this defensive effort.
Loss of one, second and 11. White out of the gun with Slayton. Just over three to play. White dropped it, and he gets it back. Hannibal falls on top of him, but he was able to get it back.
You can see Patrick White just...
I think he had it knocked out of his
hands. Yeah, he did. I did not think he was expecting that exchange, and he was just going to do a play-action fake type of thing and draw the defense and kind of caught him off guard a little bit.
Well, this is obviously the worst possession so far for the Mountaineers. They've not had many go wrong so far. It's going to be third down and 16 with 2.5 to play in the opening half. With Renee Nato, I'm John Sanders. Glad to have you with us on homecoming. We've got four wideouts in this formation. Here comes the blitz. White rolls away from it. Looks, still looking, and runs out of bounds. Pegues putting on some pressure. And a good defensive series that time for the Bulldogs from Mississippi State.
And I think you got to credit the defense with this because, you know, besides the pressure, the defensive backfield, he didn't have anywhere to throw to. He couldn't plant his feet. Everyone was covered. So he just tucks it and goes. And so that was a good effort by the defensive backfield and good pressure up front.
I'll tell you what, if he'd put his head down and tried to pick extra yardage, his body would have felt it. There were like four white shirts out there waiting for
it. It's not worth it right now with a 24-point advantage.
Pegues and Long are deep. And the punt comes from McAfee. And it's a good one. Very good. Pegues backpedals to the 31-yard line. Now tries to get outside, gets a block right there. And out to the 40-yard line before he's banged down. Halfway on the coverage along with Larry Williams. A 53-yard kick and a 9-yard return.
Great tackle by backup fullback tight end Sam Marone. And boy, he just waylaid him. He's feeling good about himself. He hardly ever catches the ball or sees the ball at all. So when you make a special teams play like that, John.
Well, when you got two tight ends ahead of you, basically, because you have to consider Schmidt in that group as well, it's pretty tough. For the last three possessions for West Virginia, a turnover, a couple of now three and outs. So they have struggled a little bit more. Actually, two three and outs on their last two. Downfield, caught at the 30-yard line. That's Co-Eric Riley, number 15, who made the catch and a big gain out of the hands of the freshman quarterback, Wesley Carroll, 30 yards.
Co-Eric Riley, and this was a well-delivered play as Co-Eric Riley just runs downfield. And this is a tough throw between the defensive backs,
wow,
between three of them. And that ball had to deliver. It was a very small window of opportunity. He throws it too short one way or the other, and it's intercepted. That was quite a throw, a big-time throw.
First catch for Riley. Dixon is in there, and that was the play fake to Dixon that really set that pass play up. There it is again. Here's the pressure. Down he goes. Back to the 37-yard line. Johnny Dingle, no fast face mask there. He's going to get another sack.
And Dingle, again, has really turned it up a notch this season. The coaches are very, very happy with his effort. He had six stops, a sack, and two tackles for loss against Maryland. But 2007 season has been his coming out party, if you will. And he was flushed from the outside. Give credit also to Mark Magro.
Absolutely. Magro was right there to force
he
him up
flushed
into
him
Dingle.
Inside and flushed him right into Dingle.
And that's a good combination that you like to see. If your linebackers come and force it back to those big men in the middle, there's no place for the QB to go.
And that's interesting because in this three-man front, usually it's the defensive guys who suck up and absorb those blockers so that, you know, they're like press agents for the linebackers.
That's
make
right.
them look good. So for once, Magro kind of turns it around and allows Dingle for a sack.
And that's especially true with the defense that they run here, the 3-4-5. And the leading tacklers, Magro, Andrews, Williams, Ivy, they are the guys that most of the time do the job.
And they do a good job with that 3-3-5. You know, they can blitz you from everywhere. The spar linebacker, he lines up on the tight end. Bandit, you know, it just, they move so many moving parts and can confuse you. It's tough on a freshman quarterback like a Carroll to read this defense.
And remember, at halftime, we will have some scores of other games, and there are some surprises. As you, what not, what to expect? That happens every week, doesn't
well,
it? What new?
It's the norm.
Ball at the 37-yard line. Bell and Burks of the wideout split near side. Wesley on the run, throws over everybody's head, out of bounds. Closest to it was Larry Williams, the senior from Highland Springs, Virginia, but there was the quarterback. Wesley Carroll simply threw it away.
Morty Ivey from his weak linebacker position, had nothing to do with the play except put pressure and force Carroll out of the pocket and throw sooner than he wanted to. That caused the incompletion.
We are in the final minute 14 of this opening half, and it's a half that has been dominated by West Virginia. But since that field goal to start the second quarter, Mississippi State's been very much in it.
They've turned it around, and I'm sure there'll be some halftime adjustments in the next 74 ticks. But Mississippi State has looked good the last two series.
And they've moved Magro up to that defensive line, makes it basically a four-man line. Pass formation, over the middle, caught, dropped. That would have been well short of the first down anyway. Jason Husband, one of the tight ends, they used the three, Sherrod, Butler, and Husband, and it was Husband who could not hang on to that one. So it's fourth down.
And Husband, who was a number one wide receiver in Mississippi coming out of high school, just curls up. He's got pretty good hands usually with five grabs, just drops one. And the big senior out of Jackson, Mississippi, big incomplete.
So on fourth down, they will kick it away. A little bit of hesitation, and Rivers is going to go back to receive this punt. And both kickers have done pretty well so far. This is going to be Blake McAdams. Pat McAfee's had a good afternoon kicking for West Virginia. He's been busier, of course, with the four PATs and the one field goal. And we have a flag down, delay of game. You start with the speed on offense, but he said their speed is there on defense, so he says you know the speed's there on their special teams as well.
Yes, and a lot of these guys who play offense and defense play special teams as well. It spills over.
Trying to get outside, but Rivers will not do it. He was forced down on the play. Now he's still on his feet. Rivers, it looked like he was tackled on the play. But Rivers stayed alive. The first man to get to him down there, it looked like Cheney would have him covered, but he got away. So that's an excellent job to get some positive yards out to the 30-yard line, a 31-yard kick.
Vaughn Rivers, a number one punt returner of the Big East with a 22.6 yards per. Boy, he's a jack of all trades. You see he's just running away from pursuit here. Doesn't go down, puts
nope.
that arm out.
He kept the knee off the ground and
keeps
got an extra 5 yards or so.
Great individual effort.
It's at the 30, first and 10. So Vaughn Rivers does his part on the return. Inside handoff, Slayton for about two, maybe now with an extra effort, gets it out for about four. Avery Hannibal on that defensive end made the tackle, and Slayton has really had to earn his yards. He had that one big play on the pass play, but for the most part, yeah, they've been tough to come by for him.
Really have. They've been keeping him in check. And again, we talked about it. He gets 55% of his productivity in the second half. So we'll see how he bounces back in the third and fourth quarter.
Fake the inside handoff. The quick out pass goes to Raynaud, and he's not going anywhere either. Fitzgerald is there. Excuse me, Fitzhugh is there. Keith Fitzhugh from Hampton, Georgia, a junior. Wrap that play up quickly. And you don't expect West Virginia to play at the high tempo they did in the first quarter. Things have really slowed down. It's hard when you score 28 straight points, you know?
And a lot of those were gifts in good field position, and they took advantage of the situation.
That will take us to halftime. The last team to get on the board was Mississippi State. They trail 31-7. And the Mountaineers will regroup and go to the halftime locker room. I think the good news for West Virginia was that great run to start the ball game, of course, by quarterback Patrick White, and the fact that White played the entire first half, although he did take one hit up high, which is the danger area for him.
And I'm sure they're not going to put him in any kind of situation. If for some reason West Virginia is lucky enough to put any more cushion between these two teams, you may see a change at quarterback.
Well, we'll see how that goes, but it's pretty much still dominated by West Virginia as they are up 31-7. But after the first snap in the second quarter, they had a 31-0 lead. So you'd have to say that the Bulldogs won the second quarter.
Yeah, they really did. And they made some adjustments. And I think they stymied West Virginia offense just a little bit in the last two or three series. They held them down inside their five and that type of thing. Made them punt and a couple of times. So I think you have to credit the defense with stepping up. And something you mentioned, John, that touchdown by Dixon certainly has been an impetus to the defense and really sparked this entire team.
But I think also after they scored on their first four possessions, actually first five if you count the field goal that they had, and you see Bob Huggins being introduced and down on the field here at halftime. We're going to have a chat with him a little bit later on. But I think some of the spark went out of that offense for West Virginia. It was not the same.
And that's something that Rich Rodriguez and his staff are going to have to address. You have to play this game like a 0-0 at halftime, throw the 24-point advantage out the window, and just start from scratch.
The bands are getting set to take the field. It is homecoming in Morgantown, and for the most part, the Mountaineers have had everything their way. Whether White is throwing, running, whatever, he has been terrific in the first half. It's 31-7. Our halftime coverage begins after.